At World Time Attack Challenge, arguably one of the more competitive classes is the open class. There's a wide range of different car manufacturers and chassis running, and as we see each year, the times keep tumbling. We're here with Benjamin from Benchmark Solutions to find out a little bit more about the Global Aircraft Services Evo 9. Now, this car is no stranger to the pointy end of open class. I believe it won open class 3 years ago. Second and a third somewhere in there as well. For a start, what's the fastest lap time it's run around Eastern Creek here?
From memory, we're looking around a mid-25 from memory. So several years ago when it won, and then it's been within the first 3 to 4 ever since.
Now, it's really hard when we're talking about lap times for people outside of Australia not used to Eastern Creek. Obviously, that means nothing. To give it some perspective, currently here today, the fastest outright competitors run a 1 minute 19.27. So, you know, that's 5 or 6 seconds there. Sounds like a lot, but you know, this is undoubtedly a very fast car. What I want to talk about is the changes, because what we see with World Time Attack is every year competitors' teams are pushing the boundaries further and further, trying to find that next little iterative improvement. So what has been focused on the car since last year?
So since last year, the engine package has been updated, transmission, a small electronics upgrade, some not a massive aero upgrade, but just some refinement to the existing package that's on there. The car was scanned and then some aero changes made for this year for testing, and then a fairly significant suspension upgrade as well.
All right, so we'll go back and unpack a few of those aspects there. I want to start with the engine, and obviously we've seen power levels rise year after year, and that's the teams again chasing those improvements in lap time. So let's find out, what is the engine itself? Obviously 4G63, but what capacity are you running?
So it's a 2.2 stroker, MIVEC variable cam engine, cast block still, not billet on this engine, heavily ported head, 280 plus cams. We're running the 9280 BorgWarner turbo, the new EFR Black Series.
All right, we'll come back and talk about that turbo as well, because that's interesting to me. The engine being a cast iron block, you know, we're seeing that's pretty unusual now at the pointy end of any of the World Time Attack classes. Yeah. What's the impetus there? Why not go the billet?
It's proven. It's tried and proven. This car started with a new block this year, just to make sure there was no potential issues with metallurgy and things with an older block. So we started with a brand new Evo 9 block, and then the changes were made internally. It's got a custom billet crank, the billet rods, pistons, everything custom to suit what
and to get it up to that 2.2 capacity.
Yeah, 2.2 capacity. So that way, it's a compromise between the billet blocks, whilst great, you don't see a lot of 4G63 ones running around, particularly in time attack, like a continual circuit, a lot in drag, but we feel there's not enough proven testing results in the longer fields of then like 10 to 15 seconds of running.
Yeah, I think it is important to understand that while, yes, the billet 4G63 blocks are proven to now 2,000 plus horsepower, it's very different running a 6 second pass down the drag strip to several laps around a racetrack. So in terms of power level and boost level, what are you at here?
So we've come out today being all new package in every area. It's turned up to about 30, 31 PSI, just over, so 30, 31 pound. Power-wise, around the 500 kilowatt, 5, 10 kilowatt.
All right, so that in terms of the other competitors in the field, which are up around that 700 kilowatt mark, you're definitely not really pushing it and well within the bounds of the factory cast block from my own experience there. So is this just a fact of running out of time? I believe you're only on the dyno last night.
Yeah, so we are being a new build. There was some delay on some of the parts, being everything's custom. So the car basically came together at the start of this week. And then, as usual, time attack fun. And hit the dyno on Thursday night. A few troubleshooting things to sort out. Back on the dyno last night, about 10 p.m., finished at about midnight. Got to the car to a level where we could be competitive. Set the gearbox up and go out, and then we'll turn out the car once we get some data from the track.
All right, so back onto the turbo side of things. So you said you're running the new EFR BorgWarner 9280. So that's a turbo that is still relatively little data around on. Can you give us your interpretation of the upsides and downsides with that turbo?
Doesn't seem to be too many downsides at the moment, compared to this car was running the 9180 last year, so kind of going to the next bigger brother, the new iteration. On paper, a compressor map is 20% roughly, give or take, more efficient with same turbine, running the 1.45 turbine housing, T4 twin scroll, and like usual. Turbo outlet temps are very impressive, dropped quite significantly from similar boost levels. So on paper, the compressor is working really well. Makes about 360 kilowatts at about 15, 16 pound for a small capacity engine. We were blown away.
It wouldn't be a bad street combo.
Oh, it's just with that, with the paddle shift, this is ridiculous.
And where are you seeing full boost on that 9280?
About the 550, 200 mark.
And you're revving it to
88 today. And then
so particularly with that paddle shifted box, given there's no need to lift off the throttle, it's just an ignition cut for the gear shift. That means that there's basically seamless power.
Yeah, exactly. So it's dropping from about 315, 320 kPa to about 260 on shifts. So yeah, it's good.
All right, so that brings me to the next point, though, because when you're running what is still a relatively large compressor on a small capacity engine, one of the problems is getting them on boost. But of course, once you're on boost, you can actually run into problems if you drop too low in the engine RPM, and you can run that compressor into surge. You've got quite a unique way of dealing with that. Can you talk to us a little bit about that?
Yeah, so this car's running a small 32 mil Bosch driver wire throttle body. It's actually being used like an electronic blower valve or like a bypass valve on the high compression side of the intercooler, the turbo outlet side. And what it's designed for is that there's the mapping in the ECU is kind of looking at basically compressor mapping from the data coming in, and then we're required to bypass the surge line, pretty much just bleeding boost off using the valve. It'll just crack open, bleed it out, sling the turbo past the compressor surge area based on turbo speed, and then just slam the valve shut and away you go.
That's a pretty smart solution. I like it. Now, it's probably a good point to talk about the electronics package there, and I know you've got a lot going on, but let's just start with the engine management system. What's it running?
Yeah, so this runs an EMtron KV8 engine ECU, tuned by Scott Kuhner at Insight.
So that whole package, the engine and the tune, the ECU, that's all come from Scott. You're involved in some other aspects of the electronics with the car, so you can talk us through what else is in the car to make it run?
Sure. So we were involved with, just had to update the wiring loom. It's a bit of a work in progress this year, but we just made a fairly substantial upgrade to cover the new sensors for the new engine package. The car was converted from cable to drive by wire. Paddle shift was added, so there's the pump and the paddles and all the inputs regarding for that. We're running a PDM 15 for power distribution.
So for those who aren't aware, PDM, power distribution module, so essentially a solid state electronics package to get rid of fuses and relays.
Yep, electronic fuse box. So everything sensor-wise goes into the dash, the ECU or the PDM, and then the relevant decisions are made regarding which needs to make the right decisions. And then the PDM's running the fuel pumps, it's running the compressor, it's running all the engine functions, dash, suspension things, so.
Now, in terms of that, you've just mentioned you've got the KV8 ECU, you've got the MoTeC dash, all of the information. The nice thing is that while one is an EMtron brand, the other is a MoTeC brand, these days it really doesn't matter because we've got CAN communication, so all of the data can be sent from the ECU to the MoTeC dash. So what are you using for a central logging location, or are you using multiple?
Yeah, so the engine parameters itself, because that's handled in a package from Insight, they're looking after that. We see all those parameters coming across to the dash as a central logger in this case. And then we're getting suspension inputs, PDM and load and current inputs, engine core engine function inputs, and just driver inputs from brakes and suspension and steering angles and so the dash.
Now, you mentioned there that you've added a lot of sensors in the run-up to World Time Attack. Can you just briefly sort of tell us what sensors have gone onto it and kind of like what the drive for those additional sensors have been?
Yeah, so we're kind of mapping the whole compressor map, or turbodynamics as it's often known. So we've got a pressure and temp on the inlet pipe into the turbo, pressure and temp on the outlet of the turbo outlet hot side, and then a pressure and temp in before the throttle body, so on the turbo side. We're running a coolant pressure and temp in and out of the radiator, and running EGTs in each cylinder. So, yeah.
Just about everything you can. Now, without getting too far into the suspension as well, because that's probably a little bit beyond the scope of our video here, I do want to just talk about some of the sensors that you've added around the suspension and some of the ones that will be added as well. Can you talk to us about those?
Yeah, so we're running the non-contact rotary suspension sensors from MoTeC.
So these are for shock travel or damper position?
Yep. So they're have a few benefits compared to the traditional shock pots we've found. A little bit less sensitive, a little bit more sturdy, and about a third of the price. So they're mounted just off a turnbuckle rod off the sway bar, and they read the suspension travel position.
Another couple of advantages with those, they are waterproof, and you quite often find with the shock travel potentiometers, the linear ones, when they're bolted to a shock, and all it takes is a mechanic to take a suspension arm out and leave everything hanging off the shock pot, and it doesn't end too well. So given the price, not a great option. All right, so in terms of the development of the car for this year, you've also mentioned that you've gone to a paddle shifter transmission. Let's talk to us about what that is, what model you've got in there.
Okay, so it's transmissions from Hollinger Engineering in Melbourne. It's the MFE9 Evo Lancer transmission. Their bolt-on tranny has a custom ratio set to suit the engine RPM and the aero load and the speed of the car that's been determined by the engineers there. So yeah, Hollinger transmission, the Hollinger paddle shifter kit, their solenoid, pretty much their whole kit.
And that paddle shift all controlled through the EMtron KVA?
Yep, all through the ECU. So the input from the compressor pump, paddles inputs, gear position inputs, and then the ECU determines what to do.
Now, on top of that, you've also got a center differential that defines torque output front and rear. Is that electronically controlled or are you mechanical there?
No, so that's running a MoTeC MDC. It was doing the job, so it's still in there. It just takes the four-wheel speed inputs, diff pressure, G sensors, and the driver position steering input, and then it just makes a clamp to your center diff. And yeah. So.
All right, look, great to get some insight on the car, Benjamin, and it's fairly early in the day here on Saturday, so still some more running to go. Hopefully work through the teething issues that every new build has, and we wish you all the best for the rest of the day. Thanks.
No worries. Thank you, mate.
If you liked that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up, and if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.